Hello everyone, welcome back to a whole new module of research methodology under the MOOCs program, which you are must be finding very beneficial by now as we have completed very many modules. Let's start with the technique that is called as projective technique, and if you remember, I am Dr. Ritu Sharma from National Law University, and today I will be dealing with a new topic called projective technique. And we will be understanding the meaning of projective technique. We will go back to the historical development of this technique and try to understand how to design and structure this technique called projective technique. We will also be talking about the types of projective techniques, where we will be dealing with the advantage and disadvantage of this research method. So when we talk about projective technique, let's start it how it was used for the first time. So, projective technique is the method initially used by psychologists. It is made up of two words. If you can see, one is project and the other one is technique. So, what is projection? A defense mechanism with which the ego protects itself from anxiety by externalizing unpleasant feelings. What is projective technique? The use of vague, ambiguous, unstructured stimulus objects or situation in which subject projects his or her personality, attitude, opinions, self-conception to give the situation some structure. It is used in clinical psychology and consumer marketing and advertising research, generally known as motivation research. It uncovers feelings, beliefs, attitudes and motivations which many consumers find difficult to articulate. It discovers the person's characteristics, modes of perceiving his or her world and how to believe in it. It enters the private world of the subject to uncover the inner perspective in a way they feel comfortable with. So, in other words, we can say that projective technique means projecting one's internal state, that is attitude, emotions, motives, values and needs, to external object. When a person is questioned to measure the extent of his knowledge of subject matter, he gets little opportunity to project himself. On the other hand, if we ask him to write about himself, he gets better opportunity to express himself, to project his personality in writing. According to Karlinger, a basic principle of projective technique is that the more unstructured and ambiguous a stimulus is, the more a subject can and will project his emotions, attitudes and values. A highly structured stimulus, as in personality questionnaire, leaves very little choice of one's own interpretation. When an individual is questioned and the question is disguised, he is more likely to give a true answer consciously or unconsciously. In explaining the project technique, Ram Ahuja gives a beautiful example. He says, if a doctor is asked why did he purchase an expensive car, he will say, because it has a comfortable ride, because it gives a better mileage, because it does not require much maintenance and so on. But if we ask him why did his brother, who is equally rich, bought a big car, he would say because he is a status seeker. A person tells the truth when he is given a mask. This indirect method of discovering an individual's attitude, motivations and defensive way of responding is called as projective technique. Projective technique is best used for assessing individual's personality attributes or eliciting his inner feeling. Since projective method avoids direct questions about the topic of interest, it is regarded as indirect data gathering procedure. According to Jickman, projective technique is an indirect mean of questioning that enables the respondent to project beliefs and feelings onto a third party, to an inanimate object or into a task situation. These tests consist of standardized procedures for eliciting responses to ambiguous stimuli, interview-like exchange. The test provides vaguely defined or unstructured tasks. Such tasks allow the subject to see, say or do what they wish to with minimal guidance or restrictions from the interviewer. Projective techniques got the name from the assumption that the subject projects his or her unconscious thought and feelings onto the screen provided by the unstructured task. Because of the emphasis on the unconscious, most projective techniques are identified with psychoanalytical theory. Projective technique is a way of transcending communication barriers. People do not share their innermost feelings. They are unaware of their underlying motives, aspirations, values, and attitudes. They fear being considered irrational or stupid and are reluctant to admit to certain type of behavior. They tend to offer answers that are socially acceptable and stereotypical in an interview situation. Instead of questioning them directly, talking about a third party or an object, the subject projects their covert feelings to a third party or object. It helps in understanding the behavior and personality of low literate consumers, children, adolescent, impulsive, compulsive, or addictive buyers. People in the face of catastrophe like Hurricane, Katrina, earthquake, war, etc. It also helps in understanding the behavior of gay and lesbian consumers. So, what is the history behind the development of this projective technique? The origin and early development of projective tests are closely intertwined with development within psychoanalysis. Indeed, Freud's theory of dreams and technique of dream interpretation may be considered the most important single source of the dominant ideas in the area. At about this time, Jung's studies in word association appeared, which also has been heavily influential in the development of the projective testing. The Roche's test, best known for all projective tests, was developed by a student of Jung's and was undoubtedly influenced by psychoanalytical theory and practice. The term projective technique came to be associated with these instruments primarily as a result of the writing of Henry Murray and Frank during the 1930s. However, the relationship between the concept of projection and these instruments is anything but precise. Indeed, one can say that projection, as the term is conventionally used within psychoanalysis today, is seldom directly involved in projective technique responses. In the two decades following World War I, there was a very rapid development and application of aptitude and ability test, as exemplified by the Stanford Binet and various group tests. Following World War II, there were comparable developments in the area of personality testing, with projective technique receiving the most prominent attention. It was during this period that the Society for Projective Technique, made up of persons involved in the study and application of these devices, was formed. At the same time, the Journal of Projective Technique, a journal that contains only papers dealing with these instruments, appeared. In addition, an extraordinary large number of articles and books concerning these techniques have been published. Even for a single instrument such as the Roche test, a total bibliography would now include more than 1,000 items. Moreover, within modern graduate programs in psychology, the inclusive of one or more courses dealing with projective technique has become standard. So, the development and application of these instruments have been associated closely with clinical activities. For the most part, individuals drawn to these devices have been working in clinical settings, often with disturbed persons and typically under circumstances where individual subjects could be subjected to a relatively intensive and detailed study. Moreover, the techniques have been considered most attractive and useful by persons who are heavily influenced by psychoanalytical theory or some variety of holistic theory. Seldom has a heavy emphasis upon the objectivity, precision, and psychometric elegance been characteristic of work with these devices.